Shiva in Steel by Fred Saberhagen. Chapter 1. 5,000 light-years from old Earth, on an airless planetoid codenamed Hyperborea, inside the small Space Force base that was really a sealed fortress, unexpected visitors were rare, and even more rarely were they welcome. The lone ship now incoming had been a total surprise to everyone on the base when it was detected about an hour ago by the early warning net of robot pickets that englobed the entire Hyperborean system. Since that sighting, Claire Normandy had been fidgeting in her base commander's office, distracted from her other duties by watching the interloper's progress on the larger of her two office hollow stages. Normandy was neat and slender, with straight black hair and coffee-colored skin. Her usual voice and manner were quiet. In her job, she assumed authority, rather than continually striving to demonstrate it. At first encounter, most people tended to think her dull and colorless. Less immediately apparent was another tendency, a love of gambling when the stakes grew very high. The commander's uniform today, as on most days, was the workaday Space Force coverall, suitable for wear inside space armor when the need for that arose. Her age was hard to estimate, as with most healthy adults, and within broad limits, chronological age was not a very meaningful measurement. The unscheduled caller's reception at the base was not going to be particularly cordial. It had been tentatively identified as a privately owned spacecraft named Witch of Endor, engaged in mineral prospecting and a variety of other small business ventures, owner and operator Harry Silver. Once, some 15 years ago, Claire had had a brief encounter with a man of that name, and she had no reason to doubt that this was the same person. Informed of the witch's approach by superluminal courier just minutes after the far-flung robotic eyes of base defense had detected it at a distance of around 1 billion kilometers, Commander Normandy had opened communications with the pilot as soon as the distance delay for radio communication fell under a minute. When the visitor, speaking calmly enough, had pleaded recent combat damage and a need for repairs, she had ordered his ship to stand by for inspection. In a matter of minutes, one of her patrol craft had matched velocities. Her people had gone aboard the Witch, and one of her own pilots was now bringing the civilian craft in for a landing at the base. Her alertness was heightened by a certain message that had come in by long-distance courier a few hours earlier and been promptly decoded. Claire was still carrying the hard copy of that message in her pocket. For a moment, she considered taking it out and looking at it again, but really there was no need. It came from sector headquarters on Port Diamond, and was signed by the chief of the intelligence service there. Below the usual jargon of routing and addressing, it read simply, "Good evidence, Commandy Secret Agent, Identity Unknown, has targeted your base for penetration. Objective unknown. You are directed to apply heightened security measures to any recent or new arrivals, particularly civilians." When Claire had first laid eyes on the message, her immediate inner reaction had been, "What civilians?" There were seldom any here, and at the moment, not even one. And her second reaction, not long delayed, "What evidence?" She supposed she would never be given an answer to the second question. As for the first, about civilians, now it seemed that she might soon be going to find out. When she tired momentarily of focusing her attention on the intruder, she turned, gazing out through a clear window at a dark horizon, the jagged line of an airless and uneven surface only a fraction of a kilometer away, but 5,000 light-years from the sun whose light had nourished the earliest years of her own life, as it had long ago those of the whole race of Earth-descended humans. The rotation of the planetoid beneath her feet was swift enough to set the stars and other celestial objects in visible motion, rising in an endless, stately progression from beyond that jagged line. Months ago, she'd learned that she need only stare for a little while at that perpetually sinking horizon to induce a feeling that the world was somehow giving way beneath her. The whole cycle of rotation was several minutes long, and during various segments of that great circle, the light of distant galaxies predominated. Looking out as it did over the landing field, the commander's office window offered a view of several robotic interstellar couriers, poised for quick launching. Each was sighted in its own revetment, widely spaced along the near side of the artificially flattened surface.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.